Thank you. My first dream, my first lofty dream, I remember because of this picture. I'm 6 years old and have been watching the documentary of the Kon-Tiki expedition with Thor Heyerdahl. And then you understand what is in front of me. I was 6 years old and I think I mixed the documentary with different songs for kids, because in my head there, I'm on my way sailing on all oceans and meet kids with different colors. It's nothing about the Kon-Tiki expedition. And I was very concerned what to bring for food. And that was all the candy I could dream of, all the chocolate I can dream of. And when I watched the documentary, I think eight years later in school, I couldn't believe that that was the same documentary. That dream lasted only 2 years. We went on holiday to Denmark and I got seasick, so I just canceled that dream completely. But I started because I grew up with stories. My parents are outdoors people, and I loved skiing since I got my first pair of skis. And the dream of the South Pole I got after reading a book when I was 8.5 years old. And I had no idea that it was something strange being a girl dreaming about skiing to the South Pole before I was 12 years old. Then I was with my school brass band to Germany with my friends, and there were 10 girls sitting in a room exchanging dreams. And all my friends, they were dreaming about a big house, handsome husband, fancy car. And I remember I was thinking, how boring to dream about something that would come automatically to when you grow up, I was thinking. Well, I learned my lesson, but when it was my turn, I said, well, my dream is to ski to the South Pole. And I remember their reaction. Was I stupid? That was a boy's dream. That was impossible. And I remember I was thinking, there must be something very wrong with me, because they were really attacking. But in one or another way, it was the skiing and being out in nature was that important to me that I kept that dream in a room in my heart. And I was 41 when I'm actually on my way to the South Pole. Sometimes, you know, family, things have to be right. And there should be some noise, sound on this video. I hope we could hear the music. But at that time, I'd crossed the Greenland ice cap. I'd crossed all the mountain plateaus in Norway. So I felt I was really experienced. And it was such a fantastic feeling to be sort of in my dream the first week. And then a big surprise, because I was pretty sure that I would make it, and that I knew what was expecting. But after a week, I came into an area with sastrugis or snowdrifts, like skiing on a frozen ocean. And my sled weighed 100 kilos, and I was pulling the sled over the top, and I had it in a rope, so I had to run a couple of steps to get it in my heels. And I started to get irritated and swear at my sled, at the sastrugis. And I want to share you, because it's so exhausting to be irritated and angry, and especially on things you can't do anything about. Because I think you experience some of the same, you know, being a decision or a person you can't do anything about. So after 3 days with swearing, I was thinking, I can't go here, swear and tear for 50, 60 days. You have to, you know, think about something. And then I got the idea. Okay, Liv, I told myself, from tomorrow, you will imagine that you ski in a gallery with modern art. And that changed my expedition totally. The energy came back. I could see figures in the snow and the skies, and my thoughts went all over. I reached the South Pole Christmas Eve 1994, and I think that's the best Christmas present, thank you, I ever got. That was the year before the satellite phone was in common use, and I didn't get my shortwave radio to work, so I hadn't been talking to anybody for 50 days. I skied 1,200 kilometers, and I got more and more energy the closer I got to the South Pole. And at that time, I was a high school teacher, and I was thinking, I have to share this joy, having a dream, fulfilling a dream. And the last 3 weeks, I was writing a sort of a management book for young people in the back of my log. And coming back home, I I started to have dream lessons with my students. And I remember one postcard I got from a boy. He said the following summer, he said, "Liv, thank you. I do not have to become a lawyer like my dad." So I did, he said I'd open his eyes. So that was fun. But I realized also that kids, that young people that need that kind of help, they don't read books. So and when I got a letter from Anne Bancroft, an American explorer and educator, she asked me if I wanted to cross the Antarctic continent with her and combine it to promote a curriculum about how young people could fulfill their dreams. I, of course, said yes. So we planned a long trip, 3,000 kilometers over the continent. We put up four goals or obstacles: to be the first women that cross the Antarctic continent, to create the biggest internet education program ever, to remain friends on the other side and have fun. Important. There's some fun training with going on an expedition, like ski sailing here on Great Slave Lake in Canada, but also some boring stuff. Getting your back strong and your thighs strong. And when you meet people, especially in the logros, also at Oslo, they in the beginning, they didn't meet my eyes. They were just looking out and said, I think they were thinking, what's wrong with that woman? But it's heavy sled, so it's good to be prepared. We had a great expedition. We were communicating every day with kids. And at this point, we know that 3 million kids in 116 countries are following us. This is 12 years ago. So that's sort of, we started to think about new things. There was very little wind on Antarctica 10 years ago, and we were far behind schedule. So we were sailing when the wind picked up. We were sailing 10 hours, 12 hours, 14 hours, and the biggest problem that we fall asleep on skis. So it's but we reached the pole, and we continued, and here I can see the Transantarctic Mountains on the other side. Here's on the shelf on the other side, and we remained friends on the other side. And, of course, started to plan new projects. We had two projects on the Arctic Ocean. As you see, it's melting, and it's dangerous. Because we really realized that we needed more people on our team to reach out all places on the Earth. So we got these lofty dreams we ever had, and that was to ski to this, we call it the Access Water Project, having one woman from each continent to anchor sort of the curriculum on each continent. And the goal is to, you know, raise the awareness, this is starting at the bottom of this slide, raise the awareness for 50 million youth, create engagement, and if we have 25% really eager to follow us. And we are launching the Access Water Project in Antarctica. It's symbolically the world's biggest freshwater resource. And women are from each continent. There are different ages, different religion, different experience, and so on. So symbolically, we have to work together for 70 days to reach the pole, as we all have to work together to solve the freshwater challenges. The methodology can be used all over, the three A's: awareness, analysis, advocacy, and action. And here's the team. We have been in Norway for, the second time. We had a really heavy storm the last winter. That was good, so the learning curve was really, really steep. The youngest is from Africa, from Cape Town, and coming into a storm with 25 square meters, the speed is pretty scary. But they're mentally strong, and they also want to be, if it's in a bigger scale, they want to make the world a better place to be. And I'll let you meet some of them on this video.
I think this is bigger than I ever imagined.
Our goal, I think, would be to bring awareness and to show people that we need to make a difference and we need to impact and motivate each other, have an impact on each other's lives to really bring about change in the world.
Nothing is impossible. the limitation is only in mind. Once you make up your mind, you can do anything.
I think the strength in the group is the values that we all share, the passion that we have. Some more so for the physical side than others, but I think at a really fundamental level, we believe in people, and we believe in the human spirit and being able to achieve things and change people's attitudes. That is the strength.
We'll tell other women also this is also possible to develop that can-do spirit.
And I think that we'll make a very big impact, hopefully, in the world and in raising awareness on the challenges we face, especially as women.
Change the attitude, to change the vision, to change the consciousness. And when you are going right direction and you do one step at a time, then you will be there, that's for sure.
And you can follow this dream and dream project on yourexpedition.com. Thank you. Thank you.